Matthew Bell es profesor de alemán y literatura comparada en King's College, London. Es especialista de Goethe, de la historia de la literatura y del pensamiento alemanes del siglo XVIII, y XIX, y ha investigado también la persistencia de la tradición clásica en el siglo de las luces, la historia de las ciencias humanas, y especialmente la psicología y la antropología del siglo XVIII y XIX. Empezó con Goethe y su primer libro se llama Goethe's Naturalistic Anthropology, Man and Other Plants. Esto lo siguió con un libro que es el libro que yo conocí su trabajo, que es The German Tradition of Psychology in Literature and Thought, 1700 a 1840. Y el libro que finalmente me hizo invitarlo, nos hizo a Mónica y yo invitarlo a esta serie, es un libro que se llama Melancholia, The Western Malady, que es un libro realmente muy hermoso y muy valioso para este tema. And well, without more to say, I paso la palabra. Welcome.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for the. That must be the best introduction I've ever had. But since I don't speak Spanish, I don't actually know. So, but no, thank you very much to. Thank you to Fernando for the invitation and also organisation. It's a great pleasure to be. Actually, before I start, normally I speak very loud from years of lecturing to students, and I'm being amplified. Am I going to be really, really loud? Is it too loud, or is it okay?
Just like that. Just like that is perfect.
Right. So I'll try not to shout. Okay. I'll try not to shout. Yes. And I've got this, which is great. So yeah, it's a great pleasure to be in Barcelona. Unbelievably, this is my first visit to Barcelona. It's great to be here at the Institute of Catalan Studies, and in particular on the site, or near the site, of one of Europe's great historic hospitals. Wonderful to be contributing to this lecture series. I'm going to say it in Spanish, or in Castilian. Tienen historia las enfermedades mentales. That's the best I can do. Now, this is going to be slightly controversial in a number of senses. In one sense, because I'm actually going to answer the question, which is unusual for academics. So I'm not going to be providing you with lots of historical material. I'm not going to be discussing lots of historical evidence. I'm not going to do that. I'm going to be discussing what I think is actually a philosophical question. But first, before I start, just a quick word about myself in addition to what Fernando's already said. My expertise is really in modern literature and in intellectual history, though in a former existence, I was a student of Greek and Latin. And unlike most scholars of literature, unlike most scholars of literature today, I believe quite strongly in the special status of science. So having said that, well, I hope help to explain what I'm going to say now. So, let's hope I can work this. Yeah, okay, great. Now, reading the ancient medical writers on mental illness can often feel like panning for gold. The rewards are very infrequent and usually very, very small. You spend a lot of time sifting through rubbish. Pages and pages of strange symptoms which seem unconnected to any actual mental illness that we know today, or bizarre prescriptions for remedies that can't really have helped the patients at all. So here's just a couple of examples. In the De Melancholia of Rufus of Ephesus, we hear that melancholics can suffer from an illness in the spleen, which causes pricking sensations on the skin of their abdomen, similar to ants moving. And among the foods recommended for the treatment of melancholia, because, of course, ancient medics like to prescribe a healthy dietary regimen, that's very important. Among the foods recommended is the meat of the black kite, Milvus migrans, which is not a bird that I would choose to eat because it normally hangs around rubbish tips. There's some black kites and some rubbish. But in amongst all of this bizarre and often random stuff, you do sometimes find nuggets of gold. So in this passage, Rufus discusses how a physician should communicate the diagnosis of melancholia to a patient. Do not make the patient suspect that he has melancholy. Rather, just treat him for indigestion. Help him against his excessive belief, terror, and joy, and keep him from too much thinking. Now, obviously, deceiving a patient is not good clinical practice, but it does seem to me that Rufus has hit on a very important point. Patients suffering from melancholia, or indeed from major depressive disorder, as defined in the American Psychiatric Association's Diagnostic and Statistical Manual, do indeed experience unhealthy, excessive levels of thinking. And on the literature of the cognitive psychology of depression, this is usually termed rumination. Some recent research has defined the phenomenon more specifically in terms of self-focused attention, the tendency to think compulsively about oneself seems to be a typical psychopathology of depression. Now, returning to Rufus, the point Rufus seems to be making is that the diagnosis of melancholia could cause a patient to focus on his own mind and thereby increase a tendency, which is already present in the illness, for self-focused attention. Whereas a diagnosis of indigestion doesn't carry the same danger, obviously, because it has no psychological content. Now, many historians will object to the move I've just made in interpreting Rufus in this way. I seem to be saying that Rufus was right in his diagnosis, if not in his, obviously, in his recommendation to deceive the patient. He was right because he identified a symptom of a real illness. And I've drawn a parallel with modern research that has identified self-focused attention as one of the features of the cognitive psychology of depression. Both Rufus and this research on rumination have correctly identified an aspect of the disease. And you'll see that in the last two sentences, I've made a further claim. I've assumed that melancholia and depression are not only the same thing, but also that the thing they are is a real thing, an actual disease. And at this point, historians of mental illness might be feeling rather uneasy, and some philosophers of science might not be too happy either. Now, let us for a moment, forget the philosophical question whether melancholia and depression are real things for the moment. We'll return to it later. But first, what I want to ask is this. is it meaningful to say that ancient melancholia and modern depression are the same thing? Or I could put the question more more cautiously. I might ask whether the problem of excessive thinking, identified by Rufus, and the pathology of rumination or self-focused attention, studied by modern psychologists, I could ask whether these are representations of one and the same entity. And this, it seems to me, is one of the central questions in the history of mental illness. Now, in order to answer this question, I am going to build on work by Jennifer Radden. You may know her as the editor of this excellent anthology of writings on melancholia and depression. She's also written several very closely argued philosophical papers on the history of mental illness, and it's one of these essays that I'm going to be using as the title of the essay at the bottom there. Sorry if the type's a bit small. Jennifer Radden is a philosopher, but that's important to know. Now, Radden argues that melancholia and depression are not the same thing. To be more precise, the set of symptoms presented by the tradition of melancholia, from Hippocrates up to the early modern period, say, on the one hand, and for the shorthand, I'll just call this the tradition of melancholia. So anything really from Hippocrates right up to, sort of, say, Burton or whatever. The tradition of melancholia, yeah. So, on the one hand, the tradition of melancholia, and on the other hand, the modern disease construct of depression, developed since Emil Kraepelin, say, at the end of the 19th century. So the tradition of melancholia and depression since Kraepelin, Radden concludes that these two constructs do not describe the same entity. Now, in some ways, Radden's argument is quite straightforward. It has two parts. First, she wants to establish what empirical resources we have for constructing the nosological category, whether it's melancholia or depression. How do we make our ideas as historians of melancholia and depression? And the conclusion of that part of her argument is that we have no sound basis in biochemistry for constructing the categories depression and melancholia. There is no underlying biochemical basis for either disease construct. Now, that's not to say that biochemical data doesn't exist. Of course, it does. The point is that the biochemical data is not yet of sufficient quality to allow us to construct a reliable nosology for depression on a biochemical basis. Constructing a nosology for depression on the basis of biochemical data would be bad science. And in the absence of such a biochemical basis for depression, we have to use more visible data. The symptoms that patients report to their doctors and the behaviours that doctors observe. In other words, Radden follows the view of psychiatric nosology. Oh, yes, it's all going so well. She follows the view of psychiatric nosology first expressed in the third edition of DSM and reaffirmed in subsequent editions. And this is what the editors of DSM-3 said about their approach to nosology. This approach, they say, can be said to be descriptive in that the definitions of the disorders generally consist of descriptions of the clinical features of the disorders. The features are described at the lowest order of inference necessary to describe the characteristic features of the disorder. Now, this kind of nosology, this method of constructing disease categories, is, as Radden puts it, descriptivist. That's the way philosophers talk. We know what she means. It's concerned only with describing the manifest clinical symptoms, things like low mood, self-reproach, anhedonia, and so on. It has no interest in causal or biochemical factors. So, if we wish to compare the constructs of depression since Kraepelin and the tradition of melancholia, we have to adopt this descriptivist approach to the disease and compare only the self-reported psychological symptoms and the observable behaviours. Okay? And so far, I think the argument is absolutely fine. I fully agree. And later in the lecture, I'll be giving some more reasons why I think Radden is right. Now, that's the first part of the argument. The second part of Radden's argument concerns the comparison itself. So, and again, it's a very simple argument. If, when we compare two sets of symptoms and behaviours, if we find that there are more similarities between them than there are differences, we should conclude that the two sets, tradition of melancholia and depression since Kraepelin, are one and the same thing. But if the comparison reveals more differences than similarities, we should conclude that they're not the same thing. And Radden duly compares the two and comes to the conclusion that they are not the same. Now, this is where I think Radden has got things slightly wrong. And wrong on methodological grounds, because it seems to me that Radden is being inconsistent. As we'll see, in her argument, in her argument against a biochemical nosology, Radden applies a criterion of good science. Biochemical nosologies are, as things currently stand, not good science. However, and this is where I think her argument breaks down, when she comes to compare descriptions of depression since Kraepelin and the tradition of melancholia, okay, the descriptivist comparison, she forgets the criterion of good science. And this inconsistency, I want to argue, is problematic. And in fact, once we do apply the criterion of good science consistently, we'll find that ancient melancholia and modern depression do in fact describe the same entity. And that's going to be kind of the main argument of what I'm going to be saying this evening. Now, this of course raises further questions. What do we mean by good science anyway? And why should historians of science be interested in it? So I'm going to return to that question at the end of this lecture. So, let's just talk a little bit about the biochemistry. In his History of Melancholia and Depression, Stanley Jackson described the various attempts made during the long tradition of melancholia to find some kind of physiological mechanism for the disease. He called this a parade of theories. And he contrasts this with what he calls the remarkable continuity in the psychological descriptions of the disease. Yeah? So the implication is that, on the one hand, the psychological and behavioural symptoms, this remarkable continuity, are the products of accurate observation. Whereas the biochemical, the physiological explanations are the result of the application of theories that were probably wrong, may have been fashionable at the time, had no empirical justification. Now, it's easy enough to show that the ancient physiological theories were wrong. The theory of the black bile, melaina cholera, as in melancholia, was obviously implausible, even by the standards of ancient Greek medicine itself. The black bile theory suffers from several well-known and fatal problems, which I'll just mention a couple of them quickly. First, the earliest evidence we have for melancholia, the disease, is in the writings of Hippocrates. And consequently, most historians have quite wrongly assumed that the black bile model was indeed devised by Hippocrates. In fact, Hippocrates makes no mention of black bile, melaina cholera, anywhere. He only talks about a disease called melancholia, not about black bile as a substance. Second, in the Greco-Roman medical writings, the other three humours, blood, phlegm, and yellow bile, making up the tetrad with black bile, the other three humours are commonly observed. But black bile is not. Nowhere in the Greco-Roman medical writings is there any direct evidence of the existence of black bile. We find only indirect indications, for instance, such phenomena as unusually dark fecal matter, brown urine, or effects on the colour of the skin, and so on. None of which is actually black. Third, none of these indirect indications of black bile has any connection with the substance bile, which in living humans is only found in vomit, in living humans, or at least visibly so. And fourth, some medical writers of antiquity did not in fact think that melancholia was caused by black bile or by an excess of black bile. They thought it was caused by normal yellow bile that had been turned black by excessive combustion in the gut. So, whereas some ancient medics thought that melancholia was caused by an excess of black bile, others thought it was caused by the burning of yellow bile. So, in summary, there's practically no evidence for the existence of such a thing as black bile, even in the writings of the Greco-Roman medics. Even in those writers who are convinced that the theory is correct, none of them provides any evidence for it, and no consistent picture of it emerges. Now, of course, it would be surprising if it were otherwise. After all, Greco-Roman medicine had virtually no understanding of biochemical processes in the body. The technology for biochemical analysis simply didn't exist. But what about modern medicine? Is there any evidence for an underlying biochemistry of depression? There have been some hopeful signs, but as things currently stand, there is no well-justified model of the biochemistry of depression. The most promising theory concerns the monoamine neurotransmitter serotonin. We all know about serotonin. Yeah. The class of psychopharmaceuticals known as the selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors, the SSRIs, things like Prozac and sertraline and so on, they are thought to have a positive effect on depression by reducing the reabsorption of serotonin into the presynaptic cells and so increasing its concentration in the brain. So antidepressants cure depression by increasing levels of serotonin. It's the theory. Unfortunately, the serotonin theory suffers from several fatal problems. First, there's a strange delay in the effectiveness of SSRIs. So whilst the effect of taking SSRIs on brain chemistry is more or less immediate, and within a day or so, the brain chemistry changes. On the other hand, the psychological effects are much slower. And this delay is really not well understood. Second, whilst the SSRIs work by increasing concentrations of serotonin, other drugs that operate in the opposite manner, by enhancing the reuptake of serotonin and so reducing its concentration in the brain, these other drugs have shown to be equally beneficial. Yeah? Yes, Irving Kirsch. Right, okay. We're told that both reducing and increasing serotonin levels in the brain is beneficial to depression. So what sense does the serotonin model actually make? Third, the evidence for the efficacy of SSRIs is in any case disputed. SSRIs may in fact be no more effective than placebos. Fourth, there is a theoretical problem concerning what Jennifer Radden rather oddly calls drug cartography, but more familiarly, I think you may be familiar with David Healy's work. David Healy calls it the pharmacological scalpel. And the theory goes like this. If a drug has the effect of making people feel less anxious, then it can be inferred that there's an illness, let's call it anxiety, which results from a brain state upon which the drug works. So, rather than proceeding in the normal fashion, identifying an illness and then developing a drug to treat it, the pharmacological scalpel functions by defining an illness on the basis of the operation of a drug, which is a circular argument. In order to justify prescribing these drugs, we use the drugs to define an illness that responds to them. And as David Healy has very eloquently shown, the definition of depression in DSM is to a large extent an artifact of pharmacological research. Now, Radden has other arguments of a theoretical nature against the biochemical model of depression. My argument is slightly but not materially different from her. I focused on the serotonin theory, which is, I think, the most plausible theory we have for the biochemistry of depression, because I wanted to show that the science supporting this idea of a biochemical underpinning of depression is just not well justified. And it's the absence of justification which is the important factor, and it'll become clear later why I think the absence of justification is important. Now, let's get on to the actual comparison, this descriptivist comparison of melancholia and depression. So, as we've said, in the absence of a well-justified model of the biochemistry of melancholia and depression, Radden argues, correctly to my mind, that we can legitimately fall back on a non-causal, descriptivist account of the psychological and behavioural symptoms. So if we want to play this historical game of deciding whether melancholia and depression are indeed one and the same thing, we can compare descriptions. We can compare descriptions in the tradition of melancholia with descriptions in depression since Kraepelin. So let's do it. Here we go. Let's start with, I'm going to give you two examples. First, Hippocrates. This is a woman from Thasos, whom Hippocrates diagnoses in book three of his Epidemics, though sadly he was unable to cure her. On the day of her death, he sums up the situation as follows. Coma was present. Aversion to food, despondency, sleeplessness, irritability, restlessness, the mind being affected by melancholy. Okay, so that's Hippocrates' Woman of Thasos. And this is DSM-4. Now, I'm sorry I've used DSM-4 because it's what happened to be on my bookshelf. But DSM-5 is really pretty much the same. So there we go. Five or more of the following symptoms, da-da-da. One, depressed mood. Two, markedly diminished interest or pleasure, da-da-da. Three, significant weight loss, or weight gain. Four, insomnia or hypersomnia. Five, psychomotor agitation or retardation. Six, fatigue or loss of energy, da-da-da. Seven, feelings of worthlessness. Eight, diminished ability to think or concentrate. Nine, recurrent thoughts of death. Suicidal ideation, and so on. I think the items in these two lists of symptoms look quite similar. So let's put them into a table, because we always like a table. So there we have Hippocrates' Woman of Thasos on the left and DSM-4TR on the right. Now, obviously there are some problems with this table. The symptoms are clearly not identical. Some of the DSM symptoms are simply absent from Hippocrates' diagnosis. Suicidal thoughts, for instance. And also some of my comparisons are a bit forced. Irritability is not exactly the same as diminished ability to think or concentrate or indecisive. Not really the same. But on the other hand, I could have arranged the list differently. I could have highlighted other similarities. For instance, Hippocrates talks about aversion to food, and we could have compared that with DSM's markedly diminished interest or pleasure in all or almost all activities. But of course, we should not expect an exact correspondence. Nearly 2,500 years separate Hippocrates' Epidemics and DSM. That's 2,500 years of linguistic, cultural evolution and revolution. And in fact, considering the gulf of time that separates these two data points, if you like, the similarity is really quite remarkable. So I think on the basis of this, we have actually satisfied Radden's criterion. There is more similarity than difference. On a descriptivist level, ancient melancholia and modern depression would seem to be one and the same thing. Now, Radden, as we noted earlier, reaches a different conclusion. Whiz back to see what she says. Yeah, melancholia and depression are not to be understood as one and the same. Why? Well, the reason, I think, is quite simple. Whereas my comparison uses one passage from Hippocrates and the definition from DSM, Radin compares two very large sets of material from sources ranging from, well, in the case of the tradition of melancholia, ranging from Hippocrates through Galen to Timothy Bright in the late 16th century, Robert Burton, the beginning of the 17th century, and even Philippe Pinel around 1800. All of this, she says, represents the tradition of melancholia. Now, one obvious objection to this is that it draws on material from a span of over 2,000 years. And we might well ask how coherent a picture of melancholia you could possibly hope to form from such a historically diverse set of sources. Now, as it happens, I'm not particularly interested in that point. What concerns me more is the quality of the material. Consider Burton. In The Anatomy of Melancholy, Burton gives us copious examples from the ancient and, in his day, modern medical literature. But Burton himself was not a medic. He did not, as far as we know, do any empirical observation, not even of himself, or at least he doesn't represent it in the anatomy. His material is all secondhand, and much of it is fanciful and driven by obviously non-scientific criteria. For instance, his discussion of religious melancholy, this is a long section of The Anatomy of Melancholy on religious melancholy, which is a category Burton invented. This discussion of religious melancholy is obviously driven by a desire to attack forms of Christianity that Burton disliked, in particular, low church Protestant enthusiasm. So I have a problem with how Radin constructs her idea of the tradition of melancholia. I also have a problem with the way she constructs depression since Kraepelin. For instance, Radin is convinced that depression is a disorder of loss and self-loathing. As evidence for this, she cites Freud's essay, Mourning and Melancholia. Now, for all Freud's undoubted influence on 20th century views of mental illness, even on the early editions of DSM, of course, there is very little scientific warrant for his theories. So my problem with Radin's argument can be formulated as follows. In rejecting causal biochemical models of depression, Radin applies a criterion of good science. As things stand, the causal biochemical models of depression don't have sufficient scientific warrant. However, in making her descriptivist comparison between melancholia and depression, she does not apply the criterion of good science. She doesn't want to confine her data sets to symptoms that are well justified by the evidence. But you can't have it both ways. Either you apply the criterion of good science or you don't. There are reasons for doing both, but don't mix and match. Now, conclusion. Right. Now, you might ask why all of this matters. Have I really come all the way to Barcelona to speak to you, to criticise a paper by a colleague whom I respect greatly? Well, there is, I think, a larger question here, and it relates to the title of the lecture series, Tienen historia las enfermedades mentales, again in Spanish. Don't often get to say things in Spanish. My question is not exactly whether mental illnesses have a history, but what kind of history they have. Or rather, to be more precise, what kinds of histories they have. Now, in his Knowledge and Social Imagery, it's a foundational text of the so-called strong program of the psychology, sociology of knowledge, David Bloor argued that when we try to explain why a given belief about the structure of the world comes to be held, the explanations that the sociologist gives should be agnostic with regard to the truth or falsehood of the belief in question. Yeah? So the sociology of knowledge, as he puts it, would be impartial with respect to truth and falsity, rationality or irrationality, success or failure. The explanations will appeal to social causes. And the same kinds of explanations, social explanations, will be applied to both true and false, rational and irrational beliefs. That's to say, the fact that a belief is warranted or justified by evidence for it cannot be counted by the historian as a cause for a scientist holding that belief. Whether scientists are justified in their beliefs or not is irrelevant to the historian of science. Apply this to Radin's argument about depression and melancholia. Depression is not what scientists are justified in saying it is. Rather, it is whatever the writers in that tradition happen to think it is. Or, as Radin herself puts it, what counts as melancholia is whatever we find with any consistency in the documentary historical evidence. And in that sense, Radin is in accord with Bloor. She's not interested in whether the models of melancholia are well justified. Now, Bloor's symmetry principle, this is the symmetry of explanations, the symmetry principle is designed to regulate the work of historians of science. This is really what it's for. So, according to Bloor, if one were to think about something a bit more tangible than mental illness, a history of cancer, for instance, would be agnostic as to whether the theories of cancer were well justified or not. It could not be a history that moved towards where the study of cancer is today. In fact, it would not even be a history of the entity cancer. Because for Bloor, these scientific entities, cancer, the same thing applies to depression, don't actually exist independently of the social institutions that create them. The objects of scientific, I'll go into this a bit more afterwards if you want. The objects of scientific study are instead generated by the work of scientists. And that work is conditioned by the social nature of the scientific enterprise. So each time an entity is constituted, the way it is constituted will depend on the scientific institutions existing at that time. And each time those institutions change, and they will change frequently and significantly, because such is the nature of social formations, then the objects of study, the entities, will change. So if we ask the question, do mental illnesses have a history? The answer is, if we follow Bloor's symmetry principle, no, they don't. There might be very interesting histories of other kinds, histories of mental institutions, histories of psychiatry as a discipline, histories of the language that we use to describe mental illness. But the question that Radden asks, are melancholia and depression the same thing, becomes a meaningless question. Now, the question whether Bloor's symmetry principle is valid, that's a philosophical question that is beyond my competence, though it should be clear from what I've said so far where I have chosen to stand on the issue. At various points, I've emphasized the importance of justification. Whether a scientific belief is justified does matter. It matters to how we as historians understand the way science works. Obviously, it matters for scientists. It would be a very strange world, if scientists were not concerned with justification. At the very least, as a kind of, if you like, a kind of Kantian regulative idea. We can maybe talk about the ins and outs of that later. I'm going to leave the task of stating the significance of justification to a philosopher who is much cleverer than I am, Bernard Williams. These words are very frequently quoted in the literature on the philosophy of science, and there's a good reason why they're quoted so frequently. This is what Williams says about what's distinctive about science. In scientific inquiry, there should, ideally, be convergence on an answer, where the best explanation for the convergence involves the idea that the answer represents how things are. And this seems to me to convey the nature of the scientific enterprise very well. It conveys the significance of justification. It conveys the fact that science itself is evolving, the fact that the objects of science, these entities, are in a sense moving targets, and the fact that good science does indeed depend on scientists reaching some form of consensus on how things are to be done. It even leaves space for philosophers of science to intervene and to guide scientists towards best practice. So, my argument comes down to this. If we want to make sense of Radden's question and of why her answer to it might be wrong and why my answer to it might be right, then we will need something like Williams's principle. Only this will allow us to do narrative history of scientific entities, things like melancholia, depression, and so on, assuming, of course, that that is indeed what we want to do in the first place. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Matthew. This was a very rich talk and very clear. You raised maybe more questions than you answered. So.
Floor is open. I should have apologized around, but
Well, it's interesting that, of course, one of the things I think you contributed to a title question of the series is that you complexify the conditions for answering that question quite considerably, because you just show that the answer depends to a very large extent on what one thinks are the condition of science itself, or knowledge, or legitimate knowledge.
Yeah.
Or maybe we don't necessarily have to use the word scientific, because your criterion applies to the knowledge produced in antiquity, where there was, you know, not necessarily an idea of science in any modern sense. Justified, and so I think that does complexify the picture considerably. My intuition about that question in the case of melancholia and depression was something like the following: is that they are the same thing in the respects that you pointed out, but they are also very different, because melancholia, contrary to depression, was seen traditionally, in the tradition of melancholia before psychiatry and so on. And perhaps this is a view that's too much influenced by, you know, Burton and so on, was not only a disease, but was a sort of way of being in the world that had not only pathological connotations, but also positive connotations, which depression, in principle, doesn't have. And so where melancholia differs from depression is in something like its nature as a cultural object, and something like its place in the self-representations, at least the learned self-representations that a culture gives itself. What do you think? What do you think of this? It, of course, escapes. It's not the same question as whether. It's not the same as Radin's question. But it was my take on my initial intuitive take on this problem. And that's why, for example, many of the commentaries of the film Melancholia.
This is the Lars von Trier. Lars von Trier film.
Lars von Trier's Melancholia. It has often been commented upon as a film on depression, and I tended to see that movie. Although, yeah, okay, sure, there is depression. You know, it's hard to deny, but. I tended to see it because of its aesthetics and because of its, you know, connection to the destruction of the world and this planet and so on. I would rather tend to see it as, tend to place it in the tradition of, not of depression, but of melancholy as a cultural object that has kind of world significance rather than as a film on a pathological condition.
Okay. Yeah.
I don't.
That's seven questions. very interesting. I'll come back to Lars von Trier in a moment. The question of the broader cultural significance of melancholia is absolutely fascinating. The first thing that I want to ask is why. Now, I mean, diseases generally, let's forget physical diseases, even mental conditions, they don't have this wider cultural significance. They just don't. Melancholia is pretty much unique. Why? Maybe we'll come back to that later. You're of course right in suggesting that the tradition of melancholia does have this broader cultural resonance. And of course, it goes back a long time before Burton. As far as we can tell, it begins pretty much as soon as Hippocrates dies. That's to say, some of the literature of the Hippocratic school starts to do things with melancholia that Hippocrates didn't do. So it starts to say, we can construct this rationalistic scheme of human existence. We've got the four humours, this nice tetradic scheme. And we could even say, we could even talk about these as temperaments. Yeah? So it's not just, they're not just physical substances, or in the case of melancholia, not just a disease. They're also temperaments, so the sanguine temperament, the choleric temperament, and so on and so on. And then you get this weird pseudo-Aristotelian text, which begins by saying, you know, why is it that all men of significance, philosophers, poets, heroes, politicians, they were all melancholics, all of them. Yeah, okay. Obviously, the author of that text was not a medic, and that's important. So this kind of turning melancholia into something of cultural significance begins really early, but not with Hippocrates. Exactly why that happens, we just don't know. But the kind of consistency of it, and the fact that it just goes on and on and on, right through. So, you know, obviously then Ficino picks up this pseudo-Aristotelian text, and it gets big in the Italian Renaissance, and then Shakespeare. You know, every Shakespeare play has a reference to melancholy in it. Every single play. Why? It's fashionable, okay, but why? So, on the one hand, yeah, we've got this tradition of the kind of cultural significance. And on the other hand, depression just doesn't have this. Well, actually, it does.
It does.
And it does in various ways. One could talk about mania, but that's different. It's bipolar and so we won't go there. But, I am absolutely fascinated by the whole, as you're aware of the depressive realism thesis. This is some cognitive psychological research has been done, which tries to suggest that people suffering from depression make more realistic assessments than people not suffering from depression. So the first bit of evidence came from a group of US college students. And they collected two data sets. So you've got a group of depressed students, a group of non-depressed students, and they asked them to predict their examination results. So how are you going to do in your exam results? And they found a really, really strange result, which was that the depressed students gave more accurate predictions. Not only were they more accurate, the non-depressed students on average, overestimated their own exam results. They all said they were going to do much better than they did. Optimism is a delusion. Yeah? There's a whole tradition in Western thought which says that being miserable is actually being realistic. So, okay, that's not exactly the same as the broader tradition of melancholia, melancholy genius, and all that kind of thing. It's not the same, but it's interesting that people have gone down that route. And also, one has to say that the depressive realism thesis is contested. We're not really sure if it works. So far, I'm saying two things. One, I'm saying Hippocrates is different. Hippocrates is different. He's different for a reason, and that is that he comes from the island of Kos, just off the coast of Asia Minor, and he inherits the Ionian scientific revolution. Yeah? three things matter when you're doing science. Observe. Put things into groups, into classes. We're not interested in individual things. We're interested in groups of things with shared characteristics. Yeah? And kick out the gods. Those are the three things that really matter. And Hippocrates... Hippocrates is a recipient of that tradition, and he sticks to it. He sticks to it really, really carefully, and is fascinated with that. And that's why I chose Hippocrates. Now, Lars von Trier. It's a great film. The word depression is never used in the film. Doesn't appear. I think there's a reason for that. I think what one of the things that von Trier is trying to say is that all these people are in denial. They're in denial about depression. They just won't face up to it. In the same way as they're in denial about this little planet that's kind of seems to be, you know, heading towards Earth and about to kind of. The other thing that what von Trier himself has said about the film is he said I wanted to move away from kind of normal understandings of depression, which see it as basically 100% negative. And he said, because it seems to me that one thing that depressed people are really good at is dealing with bad situations because they're used to it. They're prepared for it, you know. It's going to be miserable. Oh, it is. Well, I was ready for that. And that's actually what happens in the film. That's what happens, because the depressed character, Justine, turns out in the end to be able to deal really well with the disaster.
She's the only one.
She's the one who copes with it. Everyone else goes, ah. But, yeah, so, sorry, that answer was far longer than your question. But.
Well, no.
I would like to comment on the biochemical part.
Yes.
I think that I have been doing these type of studies myself in the past. Yeah. The problem with the biochemical studies, I think there is a circular reasoning. If you don't know what is depression, you will not be able to study depression. In the sense that depression is a very large denomination, probably many different types of disease. So there is this a little bit like in other mental diseases, where it doesn't happen in neurodegenerative diseases, where you have a clear lesion. So, you know, the DSM-5, you have this long list of items, and you can be depressed only with a part of those. So you can, and three or four will be enough for a psychiatrist to tell you. And this can be completely different of three or four and another one. So when you get biochemical samples provided by clinicians, they are labeled depressed. So there are not a lot of subdivisions. It's different with suicides. Yeah. But again, with suicides, there is supposed to be the extreme case of depression. But it's again, there's even genetic studies on suicide, and there is not a concurrent. So, you cannot, I mean, basically, all these biochemical and even genetic studies, all these big genetic studies that are being carried out, have a very weak point on the diagnostic.
Yeah.
And if there is no diagnostic, you will never discover. So, I mean, the risk, and furthermore, you know, the antidepressants were discovered before the monoamine hypothesis. The monoamine hypothesis, you probably know the story of the treatment of tuberculosis and all those. No? So all this is obviously a construct that has been made for many different reasons, including marketing reasons. But this is because interest in a lot of parts in society. You know, the antipsychotics were perfect to end with analysis. There was the psychoanalysis, that was a typical way of treating neurosis, for example. No? So, and obviously there is social case for that. And that, just the last point, regarding the delay, now they are fast-acting antidepressants. I don't know if you know that, but you can get to know it. And they tend to produce psychosis, by the way. My point is that the biological basis of these diseases will not be established until there is not a good way to diagnose the different types that are now called depressed. Not to talk about melancholia, it's even worse.
Yeah. I absolutely agree with what you're saying. I mean, I take the key point being that if you start to do the biochemical or indeed genetic research with a group that is itself poorly defined, you're not going to make much progress, which is not. Now, that of course was one of the reasons that why DSM-3 went in that direction. Because the people who framed DSM-3, I mean, Spitzer, most obviously, who's commented on this many times, they were aware of this terrible problem of unreliability of diagnosis. Yeah? Give the same case to two different doctors and the chances of you getting the same diagnosis are really quite poor.
And this has been done.
Yeah, yeah. So, there's lots of research that's been done, and it really is... So obviously, whereas diagnosis of a physiological disease can be pretty good, diagnosis of mental illnesses is really unreliable.
It's not blood pressure.
Yeah. So this was the whole rationale for DSM-3. Let's just forget everything except for the observable symptoms, and let's try and make those as precise as we possibly can, so we can create this reliability. Now, it hasn't really worked, and even if it had worked, it still leaves a huge problem, which is that reliability is one thing, but it's not the same as validity. Yeah, you can get reliable diagnoses that are wrong. The other thing I would say in response to your comments is that I think my argument does not commit me to actually saying what depression or melancholia is. Yeah? I don't know what it is. I really don't know. I don't know whether the DSM approach of dividing things into really, really narrow nosological categories, I don't know whether that's the right approach, or I don't know whether maybe mental illness comes in maybe only sort of two or three types. And there are all different spectra within these types. The study of bipolar is a really good example of this because it's gone round and round and round between people splitting bipolar up into, I think we got up to 8 types of bipolar. That was the biggest. There was kind of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 plus not otherwise specified, the 8th one, which is kind of like... so we got that. And then there was a change in fashion and people started saying, well, no, actually, there's only one bipolar, but it's on a spectrum. It's a bit like, hypertension or something like that. It's a gradient, So now I don't know what it is. I actually don't think for my argument that it matters what it is. To put it another way, there's a fair chance that the psychological observations are valid. There's a fair chance of that. Maybe, maybe not.
The problem is that if you want to develop therapies,
yeah,
you have to define, otherwise you will never be able to do the problem with mental diseases is precisely diagnostic.
Yeah. And not only the pharmacological therapies, but also psychotherapy and
everything.
The research done on
But it's a problem of cost. For the society. People that say are depressed because antidepressants were with you.
I was talking to Fernando about this earlier. I mean, there is some evidence, for instance, that cannabis works quite well for some depressed patients.
Cannabis works well for nearly everything.
But no one is going to do the research on it because no one is going to make any money out of it.
Well, there is compounds that are being used in some. It has to be the size of the disease. And the other thing is the antidepressants now are being used as anxiolytics. The SSRIs are more in the trend. So.
Thanks for your paper. I think that mental diseases are just the string of the relative concept of what is a disease. So I wonder I think that we cannot in no way to assimilate them to natural kinds. I suppose that you agree with this.
No.
You don't agree?
No.
So you think that mental diseases could be natural kinds?
I do, yeah.
Wow.
They are.
Wow.
If you want me to tell you why, it might take quite a long time,
I can follow your point in terms of the description of symptoms could make us to think about a similar behavior we could recognize. But the concept of mental diseases is so wide, so relative, so variable, so antithetical with the idea of any unique paradigm of what is natural science, that and of course it's so interrelated with the social context that is. That is really, to me, is not possible to go too far in this kind of arguing.
John, I understand entirely, and I think most people share your view. As it happens, I don't. let me put it like this. Paradigmatically. Biological species are natural kinds. Yeah. You want to define a biological species to me? It's not easy. There are at least three different ways, at least three, actually probably more, of defining what a species is. And they give different results. And as far as the kind of social thing is concerned, same with animals.
But they have a materiality that a mental disease has not.
Mental illness is marked by behaviour, which, as far as I'm concerned, is material. I think this is an argument which we can't resolve.
Narratives about behaviour.
I know what you're saying, and the arguments are very, very strong. It's such a big argument.
I think just to if I may, as a sort of footnote to John's comment, I think maybe I don't know if this is what's in the back of your mind is. Ian Hackett's discussion of natural kinds, which it might be better to use the term that he uses, indifferent kinds, in the sense that a stone is not affected in its sort of being by the name we call it. Whereas Hacking would say, Hacking would say, well, you know, people who are diagnosed with depression, and depending on the cultural connotation of depression, and maybe some other terms and so on, will unwittingly modify their behavior, and that in turn will modify the categories. So, things like you know, categories of mental illnesses are not indifferent, because they affect the being, the ways of being of the entities that are categorized. And I think that's I don't know if this is a little bit what was in the back of your mind.
That is part of this idea of a kind of feedback.
Yeah, the looping effect. Where do you stand on that? Sorry, I know it was your question, but it was a footnote to Joel's
question as well. So.
Yeah,
right.
Okay. There's an argument against it I have to say it's not my argument, but there's an argument against it in my book, and I just can't remember what it is, which I know is a really, really awful answer. But if you give me half an hour,
we'll come back to that over
again. This is a middle-aged brain.
We'll come back over again.
I'm more or less in the same line as John. But I mean, returning to do his to do history or as historian. Okay, you see, if I followed you correctly, you said that it's not possible to do a narrative history, taking into account, for instance, the difference between melancholy and depression. Did that follow you correctly?
I think my point was a little bit more specific than that. What I was talking about is a history of scientific entities. The argument is that if you take the Bloor argument seriously, Bloor's argument is that rationality is not universal. Rationality is just a set of local practices. Yeah? If that's the case, justification in the scientific sense is also just a set of local practices which has no validity. Therefore, scientific entities as such do not exist. They can't.
And you
they
pick a sample of cancer for that. I mean, if cancer doesn't exist, talk to the patients.
Well, exactly, yeah. Well, the mental illness is the same.
This
is one of the problems I have with the whole argument. You talk to people who are mentally ill.
Mortality rates.
I'm talking about something slightly more specific, which is a narrative history of scientific entities. Now, my answer to the question that the lecture series asks is no. Mental illnesses do not have a history; they have many histories. It depends what kind of history you're interested in writing. You know, you might want to write a history of the profession of psychiatry. Yeah? You might want to write a kind of linguistic conceptual history or something like that. And those are all interesting, they're all valid. But there are numerous different ways of constructing the history of mental illnesses. And what I want to say is that one of those is a narrative history of the entities, and it is possible to do that. It is meaningful to do that.
Okay.
I guess
mm-hmm.
what I'm
saying.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to meet you.
Mm-hmm. Well, I was revolving my head around the same question of if it's possible to do a history of mental illnesses, or just to make a history of descriptive scientific categories. And I wanted to twist a little bit of the discussion and not think about in historical terms, but in transcultural terms, for instance. And when you try to do a transhistorical analysis, for example, of depression with schizophrenia, you can do it somehow. Of course, you can do it. You can use a, I don't know, a questionnaire or something, and you can apply it to three or four different cultural settings, and something's going to pop up, okay? But, I mean, I come from the field of anthropology, so that's why I'm making those questions. Yeah. And what comes to my mind is that, of course, this works somehow, but when you look at the specific items that some specific cultures respond to the questionnaires, you find out that there's somehow no overlapping of, for example, somatization on the one hand in, for example, Canada, and mentalization in India, or in the opposite term. So somehow, everything fits into a specific set of questions and thus corresponds to the same diagnostic category. Yeah. But when you look at the items, there's no real correspondence. And what happens is that the descriptive items is just so big that not everything can fit, but a lot of it can.
Yeah.
So I was thinking about using that criteria and looking retrospectively, for example, and would that be the case?
Well, that's a very interesting question, and it is actually, to be fair to Jennifer Radden, this is one of the questions that she raises in the article I was discussing, and I didn't mention it.
I didn't have the opportunity to read it either. So
yeah, and she makes a similar point to the one you're making, which is that, in a sense, the trans-historical investigation is the same as the trans-cultural. In a sense. In the sense that methodologically speaking, it's a disaster. It's really, really difficult to do. Okay, so yes. The long version of the argument would be that depression, as we experience it in the West, and you know, Canada is kind of more or less the same as Belgium, more or less the same as, more or less. So depression, as we experience it in the West, as it's diagnosed, and indeed historically, as it's appeared since Hippocrates, it's a culture-bound syndrome. Yeah, that's to say, the ways in which it expresses itself, so the answers you give to the questionnaire, do you hate yourself?
Yeah, I do.
that kind of thing. Those answers to the psychological questions are culture bound.
The answer.
But they're also real. It's also a real thing.
Of course.
So my argument would be, well, actually, the transcultural, so let's compare
India.
Yeah, Canada and India, for the sake of argument, yeah. The transcultural provides very different answers. So if you do, it's a thankless task, but if you do it, you get very different answers from the trans-historical, actually. Because the trans-historical phenomena in the West are governed by two fundamental factors. One is a notion of science that was devised in the 6th century BC in Asia Minor. And the other is this habit people in the West have had since at least the 5th century BC, of wanting to know what's inside their own minds. India is a really good example, because traditionally, I'm not sure if I want to generalize about India as a whole.
Stereotypically, at least.
India is a really, really complex and hugely, you know, But let you know, take traditional Buddhism. Traditionally, Buddhism has tried to divert people's attention away from what's going on inside their own minds. And that is a fundamental Buddhist, a fundamental tenet of Buddhism. So obviously you're not going to get the same kind of
phenomena,
the same kind of answer, the same kind of answers to your questionnaire.
No rumination.
No rumination. No self-focused attention.
So the question, the skeptic question would be,
yeah.
Okay, if you get descriptively different traits, like radically different, why would it fit, should we fit it into the same nosology or the same psychiatric category? You know, why fit both different traits into one single diagnosis and not just, you know, twofold diagnosis?
Okay, well, that's complicated by a further factor, which is that Western medicine has traditionally tried to make the experience of people in India or China or wherever fit into Western medical models. Why? The methods of Western medicine might be broadly speaking valid, broadly speaking, but that doesn't mean the diagnostic categories are. Yeah. And so you might construct an argument like this. You might say, well, okay, there may be some kind of underlying physiological thing called depression, maybe, somatized, which is, say, experienced by people in China. And the same syndrome is experienced completely differently by people in different cultural settings in the West. And it's experienced differently because psychology of that kind, so notions, for instance, of self-loathing, are obviously socially constructed, obviously.
Yeah.
So I think we can deal with that. In theory, in practice, we found it rather hard.
But yeah.
I think we can stop here also because the room has to be empty. But we can keep chatting over dinner. Whoever wants to join us, we're going to go to the Carmelitas because Mama's cafe is closed.
Oh, Matthew,
thank you very much for the discussion and your presentation.
Great pleasure.
A great pleasure to listen to you.